Hello, I'm Colleen Holder and this is Let's Talk Tobago. Today we're in Lowlands and behind these wooden gates is an oasis, Beverly's Oasis. It features 12 luxury apartment suites and though it's set in a residential area, these walls provide you with the privacy needed. Rest assured, this place is everything the name suggests. But you'll have to stick around to find out more details right after we tell you what's happening in our stories this week. Owning your own home is no longer an elusive dream. We'll tell you how Tobagonians are accessing affordable housing without breaking the bank. Be on the lookout for the giant African snail. Tobago wants to ensure it doesn't worm its way onto this island. And for the love of books, it's our very own edition of the NGC Bocas Lit Fest.
Picture perfect with over 100 reasons to come. The intensely nurturing sensation of being so close to nature. The laid-back rhythm of the island. And of course, the outstanding Tobago Jazz Experience. 2014 brings to its main stage Keisha Cole, Grammy Award winners, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Brandy, and the man himself, John Legend. Everything on one incredibly perfect island. The Tobago Jazz Experience 2014, April 19th to 27th. Much more than music.
Let's Talk Tobago, welcome back, and we're here at Beverly's Oasis Suites in Lowlands. Now, whether you're going solo or it's a large group, Beverly's can accommodate you. The living rooms in the apartments are so spacious they can be converted into conference rooms, giving you a business option, or you can just keep it simple, making this your home away from home. Now, Argyle is home to a famous waterfall. It's reputed to be one of the most pristine and beautiful waterfalls in Tobago. But that's no longer the only thing which residents and visitors can enjoy when they're in that part of the island. Omadara Mills tells us about a new promenade that's located right next to the sea, and for fish lovers, a new facility.
These blue waters are where Argyle fishermen return after hours at sea. And besides the seaside now stands the village's very own fish market, where fishermen can clean, store and sell fish in a sterile environment.
We the fishermen just go out to sea and sometimes when you come out, coming back about 7 o'clock, and if we have a building where we could store the fish for next day, and you will benefit the people in the village, because if they want fish, they will come straight to the building and get fish.
For those who think the facility is not needed in this community, one resident argues that the fishing industry is a vibrant one.
The fishing industry in Argyle, it's coming on stream. As of recently, we have had another boat purchased by young persons in the village. The name of the boat is the Baga, I believe the boat is called. So fishing industry is booming as we speak.
And after purchasing your fish at the Argyle Fish Market, you can take in the beautiful waters and sunset from the village's promenade, named after one of their own, Henry Manbone Wilson. One village council representative, Marilyn Trotman, gives the story on the establishment of the promenade.
And they told him one thing, the first thing they wanted, a block where they could lime and thing, and he lived up to their expectation.
The fish market as well as the promenade have been in use for some time, but have been recently commissioned and rededicated by officials of the THA. I'm Omadara Mills for Let's Talk Tobago.
You must have seen the ads at some point, those warning about the presence of the giant African snail in Trinidad. It's described as a pest that poses a health risk to humans and one that destroys farms and home gardens. It's dreadful, especially because the snail has the potential for rapid population growth. But even more depressing is the possibility that the snail might make its way here. The snail has been sighted in Maraval, Degomartin, Mount Lambert and Narangues, some of the areas which Tobagonian farmers and vendors visit to collect plant material and produce. But as the saying goes, knowledge is power. So Davia Chambers will tell us all we need to know and provide us with a plan of action.
The shell is light to deep brown in color, with irregular reddish brown and yellow streaks. The actual snail color is dark brown. They have two pairs of tentacles on the head, and the shells are relatively long and narrow. That's the giant African snail, which fortunately has not yet been sighted in Tobago, and the Division of Agriculture, Marine Affairs, Marketing and the Environment wants to keep it that way.
So the main point of entry for the giant African snail would be the Scarborough Port, right? Because that's the area where planting material in the form of produce, ornamentals, people with vehicles in areas that are infested would be frequenting. That is the main area that could provide an opportunity for entry.
The snails can eat almost 500 species of plants and under optimal conditions can produce a clutch of about 200 eggs with nearly 5 to 6 clutches a year. They also carry a parasitic rat lungworm that can harm humans. This occurs if we consume food that has its mucus.
We need to be proactive and take into consideration where the goods that could bring the giant African snail to Tobago into consideration first and do a preventative measure by probably having field officers from the agriculture department go to the marketplace and probably do a survey before goods are transferred from customer to customer.
That's one suggestion. The other, the plant protection officer says, is to create a proposed prevention and action plan, which includes an eradication strategy such as cultural crushing, drowning, and the chemical application of snail and slug baits.
We'll be putting together a document that would be presented to our administrator, Division of Agriculture, and our secretary. And then the hope is that the information and the planning that we've provided would be taken up to communication levels between the ministry in Trinidad and the Tobago House of Assembly to work out on some level of limited quarantine or some level of preparing mechanisms at the port and alerting our citizenry and alerting all of the related stakeholders.
The giant African snail can live anywhere between 3 to 6 years. I'm Davia Chambers for Let's Talk Tobago.
We all need shelter, but few of us are satisfied with simply having a roof over our heads. While some of us are renting or still living with our parents and relatives, the average person wants a place to call his or her own. Most people dream of a place where they can raise a family, go and come as they please, and even pass that property on to their children as an inheritance. But in Tobago, the cost of land and home construction can be prohibitive. It's why two of the shortlisted homeowners you're about to meet are grateful for the chance to be selected.
Building contractor Gregory Johnson rents at this apartment with his wife and two children in Concordia. About 15 years ago, they applied for a house under the THA's housing projects. Now, he is one of the 36 persons randomly selected using the Oracle database program to take up occupancy in one of the Adventure Phase 2 townhouses.
Oh, it was so exciting. You know, it was really great news because we've been renting forever. And here in that home, you know, we could own our own home. This is something that we want.
Clerical Officer 2 Avian Legaton Greg is another Tobagonian who's been shortlisted for a townhouse. Currently, she lives in a single-family house owned by her mother, so she's excited to get a two-bedroom that's all hers.
Living at home, and you know, the space is not so wide, and sometimes she would need to do certain things, and you know, you don't want to inconvenience her because it's her house. But now having a house of your own means you get to use your kitchen when you want, you get to do your laundry when you want, not having to wait, you know, no conflicting schedules, etc. So that would be very nice.
But even before these homeowners can get the keys to these townhouses, they need proper financing, even though they're getting the houses at a subsidized cost of $400,000. And the Department of Settlements is ensuring that those selected know all aspects of securing financing for this kind of investment.
Well, it will give a clear indication that the person has the ability to pay for the property. It will also give the person an indication very early if there is anything that they can do to be able to own the property. In some cases, they may be able to tap into their savings.
And the homeowners are grateful for this part of the journey.
Well, coming here today with the information they give, it really helped, because I seen where we will go where finances, learning more about the process, learning more about owning a home. And this is great. This is so informative, and I really appreciate this.
Currently, there are 62 townhouse units under construction at the Adventure Phase 2 housing project. The THA hopes to start the delivery process for these persons by May 2014. I'm Umadara Mills for Let's Talk Tobago.
It's time to take a break, but coming up, a campaign to save our sea turtles.
There are now significant traffic changes in the Shore Park area following the opening of the roundabout. Drivers can continue to proceed south on Orange Hill Road from the Claude Noel Highway, but they will no longer be able to turn right into the gas station or onto the Crusoe bypass. Instead, from the Claude Noel Highway, turn south onto Old Government Farm Road, east onto the Crusoe bypass, go around the roundabout, get into the left lane, and head north onto Orange Hill Road to the gas station. This message brought to you by the Division of Infrastructure and Public Utilities.
You're viewing Let's Talk Tobago. Thanks for staying with us at Beverly's Oasis. This Spanish-style courtyard has many attractions, including but not limited to a five-tiered fountain and a swimming pool with a mini waterfall where you can just relax and soak up the sun. That's just one of the elements of a good Caribbean vacation. Now, how about if we throw in calabash? No, not the fruit. We're talking about Jamaica's literary festival that has attracted big names such as Nobel laureate Derek Walcott. That festival is just one of many held around the world. 4 years ago, Trinidad created its own, the Bocas Lit Fest. But it wasn't until this year that the festival came to Tobago. It presented this island with an opportunity to showcase local talents and get more Tobagonians involved in the literary arts.
You see them sitting in the park immersed in a book. Pass by and their heads are down writing away. You've heard the lyrics of Baby Dolls, Midnight Robbers, and Peregrinades. They are just a handful of the many who love literature. Whether it's reading or writing, they're involved in storytelling. And for the first time, the NGC Bocas Lit Fest hosted a two-day workshop where writers, storytellers, and readers in Tobago met as kindred spirits and felt validated about their love for words.
Books are really about ideas. Books are about what people think. When you become an expert, you think about the niceties of how the writer has committed the idea to the page. But essentially, what we read books for are for stories.
And the persons are showing they're interested in writing good stories, with four writers' workshops held for the Bocas Lit Fest deemed a success.
We have conducted quite a lot of workshops over the last 3 years. And you know, what has emerged out of these workshops is something for which we like to take credit, whether we should or not. It's a very compelling group of young people, young writers, young spoken word artists.
The collaboration from all stakeholders in both Trinidad and Tobago shows that persons are committed to literary advancement.
Persons who have contributed their efforts to ensure that this today event is successfully accomplished demonstrates that we are indeed committed to fostering and stimulating a greater passion for books, for reading, creative writing, and storytelling.
Over the years, the THA has supported literary events such as the Tobago Word Festival and now the first NGC Bocas Lit Fest in Tobago through the divisions of Education, Youth Affairs and Sport, and the Community Development and Culture. I'm Umadara Mills for Let's Talk Tobago.
Picture this. It's nesting time. You venture out to Turtle Beach for turtle watching, and to your horror and surprise, there are none. You're probably thinking that's an exaggeration, but one of the largest conservation groups, the Worldwide Fund for Nature, warns that human activities have tipped the scales against the survival of marine turtles. They say urgent global action is needed to ensure the future of our marine turtles. This call to action is one of the reasons a number of local agencies have set out to raise public awareness on the issues affecting our sea turtles.
Dinosaurs weren't the only ones roaming the earth ages ago. Sea turtles have also been around since prehistoric time. They were once plentiful in tropical and subtropical waters, but at present, their numbers have declined because of commercial exploitation, incidental catch of turtles in net, and loss of habitat. It's why conservation groups and stakeholders around the world, including here in Tobago, have been spearheading an effort to protect the remaining populations of sea turtles. On this island, it's a collaboration between the Division of Agriculture, Marine Affairs, Marketing and the Environment, and the Environmental Management Agency, the EMA.
The pillar of our turtles eats plastic bags and it can die, it can choke, and that can affect their numbers as well. So pollution, debris in the water, littering and so on, all of this can harm the sea turtles. And then there's also when we actively eat turtles.
All this spells disaster because the presence of sea turtles on this island has an economic value. She says they contribute to the country's economy as well, as it's a catalyst for tourism.
And we have people coming to Trinidad and Tobago to see turtles. They come for this purpose, but then they stay and they spend money for a lot of different things, and they boost our economy.
Sea turtles are also an essential part of two major ecosystems, the marine system and the beach dune system. This is why the Director of Marine Resources and Fisheries, Garth Utley, is pushing for the enforcement of laws that protects these endangered species.
It doesn't work in going at the public area, all right? Because in order to enforce any law, it becomes even more difficult when the enforcers are the ones who are breaking the law. So as I said before, the key is not only enforcement, but education.
The fine for harming protected species is $100,000 and 2 years imprisonment. I'm Davia Chambers for Let's Talk Tobago.
Most public servants are notorious for bad service. Now, this is not a Tobago or Trinidad problem. In fact, it's an issue that affects most of the Caribbean. But this island is determined to make that cultural change to ensure our public officers are professional and courteous. Work has already begun with a refresher course for employees of Tobago's assemblymen. Let's find out what are some of the lessons learned.
They are electoral district officers, the staff members who assist the THA's assemblymen in addressing the concerns of their constituents. As a result of what they do and who they work with, they are being educated on using best practice business etiquette, skills and techniques when interacting with all stakeholders.
In our line of work, we have direct contact with people in our constituency, and they would have touched on how to deal with them, you know, how to dress when you're coming to your job place, and also how to be a people person. And I believe that it was imperative that we needed to know that.
And the 29 officers who attended this seminar are being urged to treat all members of the public in an equitable and respectful manner despite political affiliations.
It's your role to provide professional support and efficient administrative services in a non-partisan manner. Because those offices are out there, when you open them on mornings, you serve the entire public.
At the one-day course, the officers also learned the protocol required when interacting with high-ranking officials, an aspect which stood out for the research officer for the Backlet Mount St. George constituency, Crystal Orr James.
What was most memorable in the workshop for me was the fact that we have a table of precedence, how to seat dignitaries, how to treat with certain persons from different countries.
It's hoped that there'll be follow-up sessions so that the officers can maintain a high standard when carrying out their duties. I'm Omodara Mills for Let's Talk Tobago.
We're taking another break, but on the other side, Tobagonian women as agents of change. We'll tell you what's being done.
ain't this what you came for?
What's up, it's John Legend. I'm very excited to be coming back to Tobago for the Tobago Jazz Experience on April 25th, 2014. I want to see you in the place, so make sure you get your tickets at www.tobagojazzexperience.com. I'll see you there on April 25th. Peace. The night I let you know.
Welcome back to Let's Talk Tobago. Thanks for staying with us here at Beverly's Oasis. Another unique feature in the bedrooms is the standalone shower units that are equipped with a sound system as well as colored lights. The showers also have a variation of settings that give you that luxury spa feeling. And as you make a mental note to check out this location, let's take you to another Caribbean destination, Barbados, where the Tobago All-Star football team competed. The group visited our regional neighbor to participate in a number of competitions and to discuss sport development programs, among other issues. Here are the details from Davia Chambers, who saw them off.
Their suitcases packed. 64 of the island's best footballers from primary and secondary schools are off to Barbados to show off their skills in a football tour, which is an initiative of the Elite Athlete Program of the Division of Sport. The footballers were chosen based on their sporting and academic performances during the last football season. They formed four teams in Barbados in a two-day football tournament against their Barbados counterparts. This program provided a forum for coaches and players to interact with their counterparts and helped the athletes to improve their sportsmanship and build camaraderie. The tour is expected to be an annual one. I'm Davia Chambers for Let's Talk Tobago.
In Tobago, religious institutions are an integral part of our society. They help to build community spirit and provide refuge to many. This might sound simple enough, but it can easily drain any institution's resources. What you might not know is that programs which essentially give to society, asking nothing in return, usually have huge budgets and oftentimes end up in the red. But it's important to keep them going. Let's hear from one of the local groups that's doing just that right here in Tobago.
In case you didn't catch it, that's the song You Raise Me Up, being played by this steel orchestra at the Pan Finals of the Youth Music Festival in the non-school category. They placed third. The Maranatha Next Generation Steel Orchestra is a gospel steel band formed late last year with young persons who are members of the Maranatha Christian Assembly Church. It's a way for them to get more in touch with their spiritual side.
We want them to play more for God as a church member than the world. And they enjoy playing the steel band and they enjoy playing gospel tune better than the calypso.
And in order for them to reach this far, they received financial assistance from the Division of Community Development and Culture to cover the cost of 8 pounds. The division also distributed checks to the Salvation Army as well as the Mount Bethel Spiritual Baptist organizations to assist them in their activities, all of which totaled $90,000. I'm Umudara Mills for Let's Talk Tobago.
The United Nations Development Programme focuses on gender equality and women's empowerment, not simply because it's a basic human right, but because research shows it's a pathway to tackling poverty. Many celebrities have lent their star power and voices to this issue. Oprah Winfrey and Angelina Jolie are some of the big names that continue to push for a greater voice for women. Some even pump their personal fortunes into projects. Well, up until now, Tobago hasn't been lucky enough to be a recipient of any of those funds, but the work is getting done. Here's how.
Did you know that a vast majority of the world's poor are women? Or that 2/3 of the world's illiterate are female? And just as startling, the fact that girls make up the majority of school-aged children not in school? That's our present-day reality, despite all the advancements in gender equality. But there's hope, because studies have shown that when women are empowered, they, along with society, benefit. Here at home, officials at the Division of Settlements and Labour want to take advantage of this. They've started by inspiring change.
The research showed that women leave over $250,000 on the negotiation table during an interview because we are afraid to ask, because we do not value ourselves enough. So when we are asked, and I've experienced it during interviews, people are afraid to ask about salary.
It was philosopher Charles Malik who said, and I quote, "The fastest way to change society is to mobilize the women of the world," end quote.
We spend a lot of time worrying as women. We get this thing in between the middle here. That's from a lot of time we hit in the head, not just because of the weave, but we hit in the head. Where's my next move? Where's my next move? Some of us, we watching the play and we telling ourselves, but the thing about it, the key is getting to know yourself. Something that really transformed my life was when I did a personality profile.
Women can also be effective change agents, and the Division of Settlements and Labour is doing just that with Tobagonian women. I'm Davia Chambers for Let's Talk Tobago.
And it's time to have your say, the segment of our program where we hear from you, our viewers. The board of the Tobago Regional Health Authority is finally in place, but theirs will be no easy task. Expectations are very high, something the chairman acknowledged shortly after being sworn in. But he has committed to exceeding the expectations of the population and to strive for excellence in the delivery of healthcare in Tobago. Those are his words. They've been put in charge of a healthcare system that's in pretty good shape, relatively scandal-free, but one that some say can benefit from improvements. So today we're asking, what are your expectations of the new TRHA board? This is what you said.
The Moa Health Center could be renovated, and I want to see TRHA renovate that health center and ease up Moa people from having to come to Mason Hall to see doctor.
I find that the health department is doing well in Tobago, because recently I heard that somebody came from away to do renal here, and they're real pleased about it.
I'd like to see that the board be on time and the workers be on time at all times. Too much legacy attitude goes on.
I find they're doing well. They just to continue improving in their health.
My expectations to the new TRHA board is the implementation of the new programs that they will be have coming on board, and that it will be good for the people of Tobago.
And that's how we bring this week's edition of Let's Talk Tobago to a close. Remember, you can send us your comments or queries on anything you've seen in this program to information@tha.gov.tt or visit us at www.tha.gov.tt. Like us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. I'm Colleen Holland. On behalf of all of us at the Department of Information, have a safe and enjoyable week. And as we go, we leave you now with a final look at Beverly's Oasis Suites.